Hello and welcome to our special five-part series titled News is Undervalued. In these times of crisis, news is not just a source of information, but it also leaves us with emotions like hope or sometimes despair. It is something we all believe in and fall back upon for its credibility. If you don't believe me, believe the BARC data. News genre showed an unprecedented growth of 298% in first few weeks of the lockdown. The number continued to be as high as 251% in week 13 and 219% in week 14. So the question we need to ask today is, despite these numbers, does the news continue to be undervalued by marketers or other industry people? So to answer this and a lot more, with me today is Mr. Vikram Sakhuja, Group CEO, Madison Media and Outdoor Madison World. But before we start, Mr. Sakhuja, just give me 1 minute. I must mention that our presenting partner is ABP News, and I request all our viewers to keep tweeting using hashtag E4M webinar and hashtag ABP News. Also tag ABP News. Welcome to the show, Vikram.
Hey, great to be here. Vikram, amazing times, crazy times that we roll in.
Vikram, I want to start with that in these times that we consume news from various platforms, every platform has a different level of credibility. So would you want to speak about credibility of news in these days, and how does it pay to be more credible?
Okay, two questions there. So let's start with credibility of various platforms. Now, you know, I just, in the last few days, I've got one. Okay, I'm just going to give you actual instances that have happened to me. I got a few pieces of news delivered to me in different ways. I got a WhatsApp about a Japanese Nobel laureate claiming that the virus had been manufactured in a lab. Then I got a CNN sort of video of a president saying that you can actually inject disinfectants to kill the virus. Then I read a newspaper article that said, I'm right now in Delhi, so that non-essential shops will also be opening up. And I saw a video of a news anchor saying that a political party had instigated an attack on him. Now, this I got, so four different pieces of news from four different sort of sources. I also saw Twitter today, which said that one poor person who was actually trying out the vaccine, some scientist, has died. Now, I have absolutely no reason to believe, or I don't know whether any of these pieces of news are true or not true. Chances are most of them are true. Now let me switch the same things around in a different context. Supposing the WhatsApp video that I got the president saying that you can actually inject disinfectants came to me on a WhatsApp. Supposing the entire CNN news was about the Japanese Nobel laureate saying that the virus was created in a lab. Supposing Facebook had told me that non-essential shops were opening. Or for that matter, a rival channel was actually writing and saying that this particular news anchor has got attacked by somebody of a political party. How does it start working in your head? To me, it works differently. So right now, chances are all news items are correct. They could be all false also. But somewhere along the line, why is it that you're tending to believe one more than the other? And I think that requires some degree of sort of introspection and understanding. To me, both credibility and trust needs to be earned. You know, around the time when I was getting married over 32 years back, my wife was a reporter researcher with Time magazine. So I remember every Thursday they had to close a copy or something like that. And they had this obsession with Checkpoint Charlie. Checkpoint Charlie was any kind of fact that has to be reported in the story has to have at least two sources, double checked, triple checked, to make sure that each and every word that you put down is correct. Now contrast that with a recent interview that I've seen where, now this is not even wrong, it is just, I mean, it's egregious, it's not even malicious. There was an IMF chief economist talking about how the entire economy is getting sort of battered, is battling exogenous variables. Now the news transcriber is putting it down as the economy is battling exhaustion, exogenous exhaustion. Now, sometime back, quite a few years back, in fact, there was a poor, now unfortunately infamous journalist now, who in America went and called the Chinese Premier Xi Jinping, Xi Jinping, she pronounced his name as 11 Jinping. Now, both of these are what? It's just stupid blunders. But I think it's symptomatic of something which is deeper, which is in your rush to get out news, there's sometimes a tendency to take on mediocrity or to accept mediocrity. And I think that's the beginning of the problem of lack of trust, credibility, and authenticity. And that is where I think the platforms that are doing it better are the ones which actually stand to have be more credible. So in my book, for me, the brand is the most credible. So BBC, to my mind, for example, I think is a very credible brand. So if they come out with a piece of news on, be it TV, be it radio, be it their online stuff, I attach a certain credibility to it. After that, I actually attach most amount of credibility to stuff which comes out in newspapers. And I think that's also because, A, there is a legacy, the entire way the editors go about it. They also sort of have the night or the evening and the night to actually see the entire copy before it actually goes. The response in a story, it gets, the lead time is probably a little bit more than it might be in online and TV place. And as a result of it, I think a little bit more quality and deliberation goes into it. And in general, I think they goof up less. Then I think I would go into TV and then maybe online editions. And it's only the news aggregators comes way after that. And I'm sorry, but bottom of the pile are the social media and the news that they sort of perpetrate. So yes, I do clearly believe that I don't think the intentions are bad of everybody. Everybody wants to give credible news. But the way you've built your entire news organization, there are some which demand and therefore demand more sort of exacting standards, and then they will command respect. So that is about the platform piece.
It is also about like big news channels also have resources to confirm from multiple sources. So they can actually bring you credible news, which perhaps a social media platform may not be equipped with.
Then I'm sorry to say, but then you shouldn't be in the business of news then. If you can't, if that's not your business, then don't be in it.
Yeah. So coming back to
Sorry to interrupt you. And I'll tell you why that's important. The reason when you started this entire session that we are having by talking about the astronomical way in which news is being consumed these days. The kind of crisis which has forced the entire world into a standstill basically has brought about a need. There's a huge, huge requirement for just finding out more information in order to be able to cope with the kind of crisis that this has hit us. So at this point in time, people obviously turn to news channels to get that. So the responsibility is enormous. And I completely believe, just like I think the entire world does, that the platform which is publishing news is fully responsible and accountable for the quality of news that they are supposed to put out. Absolutely. So yes, platforms that do it, they don't have any option but to make sure they fact check.
So I have just got this message from my technical team that we are already live on Facebook and Twitter. So you can now watch us there as well. So Vikram, moving on to my next question, we all know that TV viewership is at an all-time high because we are all sitting at home. So news has contributed significantly to this. It is the leading genre. It's almost like shown unprecedented 298% growth in few weeks. So despite all of this, is news getting its true value commercially, do you think, as a media planner?
Okay, so let's just review the numbers that you started off the session with. So yes, overall TV has grown about 40%, and it's been driven by 12% more viewers and about 25% more viewing. So average time spent is now upwards of 4 hours and 38 minutes. And TV news viewership, as you said, has trebled. So at this point in time, the entire growth in TV viewership, about 52% of that increased TV viewership is contributed by the news, increase in news. And share of news used to be about 6-7%. Now it's gone to about 17%. It went to a high of about 20%. But in the last post-COVID week, it's got a market share which is almost now similar to movies and GEC, whereas it used to be considerably down at number 4 or 5, whatever it might be. Not only is the TV news gone up, while online consumption hasn't gone up as much as TV, so online consumption has only gone up by 10%, but news online has gone up by about 76%. And there, across apps, websites, and video news, the growth is pretty, pretty solid. And if I have to look at even a Times of India survey that happened some time back, it seems that even the newspaper reading has gone up from, I think, 33 minutes to about 44 minutes, with the number of people reading it for an hour or more having gone up dramatically to about 38% of the people are reading the paper that much. So this is all sort of addressing this hunger of news and need for news that people have to are sort of satisfying by going to these places. Now, this should have actually been a bonanza time for a large number of the sort of news publishers and news media owners. Unfortunately, these eyeballs are not translating to business the way they'd like it, primarily because there is no demand. So April, and like the intermedia, we've always known as the demand-supply game. At this point in time, the April has had a demand of advertising has come really due to a crashing halt. So it's down 60-70% from what the normal levels would have been. And even that is probably on the aggressive side. So at this point in time, news would have ideally liked to have said, so many more people are coming and watching me, so take my rates up or stuff like that. But even they are being forced to discount because there isn't enough demand. Now, regarding value, the best way we look at value is on media, we look at cost per rating point or cost per thousand, which is the same thing basically. And in this, what we've seen up to now before the COVID environment is, that if you look at the various TV genres, the GECs and the new movie channels, definitely the GECs were, the news channels used to have a higher CPRP than the GECs and much higher than the movie channels. Now with the kind of growth in ratings, actually you're finding that versus the pre-COVID environment, the CPRPs of news channels are now actually very competitive. But that said, obviously, it's a competitive environment. So the discounting that's happening on news and general entertainment is even more. In newspapers, of course, because it's compounded by a lot of people believing that papers are not reaching people and all the rest of it, has become even worse. And even if people are reading the newspaper more, it's not translated. In fact, advertising has completely gone from there. And that's again impacting the pricing. So to answer your question about value, I'd say that market forces actually determine value. So at this point in time, I don't think it's being undervalued to the extent that I think news today, there were about 11 to 1200 brands that were active in a given week during on TV during these post-COVID weeks. I think last couple of weeks, all of them had news on their media plans. That shows that news is being valued. Also about 40% of all the inventory that was bought on news channels.
Okay.
So I think the value, they're getting their due share by finding a very, very prominent place in media plans. I'm sure they would want a higher price, but that price is not coming because the demand is not there.
But if 40% is going, which is compared to what in previous days, sir? Now that 40%
I don't think news genre would have commanded across the board a 40% share of all inventory at any point in time. It would be lucky to get half of that. So it's
definitely, so it's almost doubled.
Yeah. So news definitely is doing much better relatively to all the other genres.
Although at a much lower price.
Yes. Well, lower price than what they were earlier at. But at a cost per rating point also now, which is comparable to some places where they were earlier at a premium at.
So I'm already getting a lot of questions from our viewers. And before I take up the first question from the viewer, I must remind you that the session is in collaboration with ABP News. So this is this gentleman called Mr. Manish Gupta. He wants to ask you a question, that there are some newspapers, regional, local, who do their best to give credible, trustworthy news. Will they, and how will they survive impact of COVID-19 post-lockdown? It's more of a print question.
Okay, so let me take it at a broader level. Is credibility valued? And I think it's a slightly profound question. So I think the best way to answer this is in two ways. One is that does credibility of a news channel also lead to greater popularity? So that's a consumer question, subscriber question, whether you're subscribing to newspapers or TV channels. And the other question is that does a credible news channel get paid more by advertisers just because the platform itself is credible? Now, I think it's a very murky area to say that is one news channel more credible than another news channel. That's because when people are chasing a news channel or news for that matter, there are a number of factors that go into play. There is the ideology. So, you know, the proverbial Fox News versus CNN that you see in America, it's better to distance it because then you're not making it personal. If you look at India, then there's a danger of antagonizing some of my friends. So there is an ideological thing. There's no right or wrong, but there is Fox News and CNN are absolutely different sides of the spectrum. And people following the two are just subscribing to that ideology. Some people follow personalities. Some people follow the investigative capability. There are some people follow just the entire ability to break new news. Some of them are just going after sensationalism and salacious stuff. And of course, some people are going after credibility, but credibility and authenticity is one factor and probably not the most important. Now, does this translate at this point in time to more viewers? And there again, I think not, because I don't see, if I have to look across all the channels which we get, firstly, most of the news channels are free, most of them. The ones and the premium ones which are there, the ones which do charge money, they charge typically less than 1 rupee per month from the subscribers. And if you have to look at news channels or the business channels, they might go a little bit more. So at this point in time, I don't think consumer monetizability is becoming a factor to look at to actually say, does that determine popularity? Now, from a credibility, and would somebody as an advertiser pay more to be on a more credible platform? Now, this is an age-old quantity versus quality debate. So I remember when I was in Procter & Gamble several decades back, so that time it used to be this question of, would you be willing to pay a premium to be on a premium environment? And most marketers actually say that if my target audience is watching a particular, say, program on TV, and if I'm getting helping and that program is helping me get reach, then I don't want to put a premium on the quality. I don't want to put a handicap on adverse quality, because I respect my consumer. And if that consumer is watching a particular program, and if my ad comes on that, then that ad is completely acceptable. And I don't think I should pay a premium to be on a more credible platform. So I think the brutal reality is, even though we may want in our hearts the credible and the authentic guy to win, unfortunately, even the advertiser is not paying a premium for that particular person. So long-winded answer to friend Manish's question. Much as I'd love, even assuming that there are some, whether it's regional or whether it's national, if there is somebody who's really, really holding the authenticity, credibility, and integrity of the fourth estate alive, I'm afraid the consumers and the advertisers currently are not quite in the same camp to keep them afloat. They will be going more by where the eyeballs go.
I now want to take up Sandeep Shivastav's question. I'll add a little more to this. So he's asking you that with newspapers' delivery significantly impacted since the start of the lockdown, this might have also contributed to the surge in news genre on TV. But you said that even readership has gone up. Huh? But this is, you recently said, right?
Yeah. So, yes, in a word, overall news consumption has gone up. It's not that.
But maybe digitally.
I think all. TV has gone up. The entire
newspaper,
online,
because you're not getting that print.
The newspaper part, frankly, right now will remain something that we won't really get to know during the post-COVID period. anecdotally, we are hearing that publishers are probably publishing 80% of their print runs, but this is anecdotal data. From whatever I understand, ABC may not track some of this stuff this time in this quarter because of the disruptions. So at which point in time, we will really never need to know what is the circulation which happened just in the post-COVID period. So that said,
I'll complete his questions. So he's saying that while appetite for news might seem momentary, could part of the surge remain even post-COVID? I also want to add one part to it. Will this preference of marketers, you know, towards the news will also continue post-COVID?
Marketers will chase where the eyeballs go. So if consumers want to be obsessed with news afterwards also, that will also happen. But I've never been a very good crystal ball gazer, but I think once, hopefully this is behind us quickly, I think people are going to go back. There will be some residual consumer behavior impact of this entire virus. But as far as I think the TV genre viewership is concerned, news may get some residual gains, but they won't be as dramatic as what you're seeing right now. I think what is going to see the biggest spike when normalcy returns is going to be sport. People, there's been a dearth of live sport. So the minute it comes back, people are just going to jump to it and see it. And of course, when the GEC comes back with new programming, that is also going to get to see a huge surge.
So this may not continue for very long.
If you ask, my guess is that once normalcy returns, it will go back to its normal level. So it's always a very predominant genre, but I don't think it'll get 20% share.
Rupansi Surya has a question which is little to do with news. So this is the time when pharma and FMCG can rise above FCT and explore brand solutions to highlight and enhance brand value, but there is still hesitation when it comes to integrated solutions. And there is never a definite answer as to why not. Could you please enlighten as to what goes on in the brand's mind regarding this?
Okay. No, there is clearly at this point in time, the consumer is looking for certain assurances from marketers. So they are looking for reassurance. They are looking for a lot of safety and safety concerns. They're looking at even some value concerns. So if you are able to address hygiene concerns, all of these, they are looking. So if a brand has a story to tell at this point in time, there'll be a high degree of responsiveness. I also believe the trusted, this, as we've seen through some of the media, like the Ramayans and Mahabharats, when there is insecurity all around, people like to go back to the nostalgic old kind of stuff where they've derived a lot of cocooned comfort. So they will go back to those kind of behaviors. So from that standpoint, old trusted brands, if you advertise, I think they'll actually get received very well by consumers and it'll actually bounce back stronger. But I think the problem that advertisers are facing is a more short-term and a very more sort of survival one. There are three reasons why advertisers are not advertising at this point in time. One is demand-led, one is supply-led, and third is cash-led. So there are some cases where even if you have all the stock in the world, the autos and all of this world, for example, people right now want to defer purchases and of course their stores are shut. Their showrooms are shut. So where will the person go? So at this point in time, they don't want to even create short-term, forget long-term demands. They don't want to do that. Then there are others like the FMCGs of this world where demand is perfect. They're under essentials that actually are supposed to be available, but they actually have some very acute supply side problem because factories are shut. Their entire distribution networks of trucks moving from one place to another, that is all hampered. So they really, again, don't have stock and that's a supply chain issue. And then there are third kind of set of guys who might still have the business, you know, the classical, so to speak, the startup economy, which may have a lot of, which at this point in time, which are relying on investor funds and some of them have them, but a number of them might say, we have to conserve this cash. And they may not have cash and everybody's doing the proverbial, let's pay our people before we actually go and pay for advertising and stuff like that. So I think at this point in time to suddenly come in and say, why don't you do an integrated kind of solution which actually builds your brand values? It may actually do good things for your brand, but for very real reasons, which are really linked to demand, supply, and or cash, I think people have to sort of postpone these.
We have 5 more minutes before we have to close this session. I can take, I think, one more question. Gautam Datta wants to, he's been sending this question repeatedly. He wants to ask you, we are getting shares, but not price. Planners never value credibility and perception. Is this correct?
We are getting shares, we are not getting price.
Yeah.
So, by shares, I presume they...
Social media shares, footfall on social media kind of thing.
So, sorry, this question is coming from what, a media owner?
No. He's not a media owner. But he wants to understand that.
So we are getting shares, but not price.
Not price. Earlier he asked his credibility and bias.
I'm afraid I haven't quite followed the question. News, we are getting shares, but not price. By that, it means that news is getting shared, but it's not getting paid for in advertising.
Yes.
I think
yes.
I tried to answer that. People are hungry for news, but right now there is no demand for advertising. So that's why I tried to explain that in the value piece. So right now, at least 40% of the inventory is going to news. If you talk to your brethren in GC, movies, music, even kids, which actually kids genre is actually seeing a lot of growth. But even they are not getting as much traction as maybe news channels. So if I was a person in the news thing, I'd be actually reasonably satisfied with what I'm getting because the others are getting even less.
3 minutes, I'll take one last question. With so much clutter in the news genre, both in English and Hindi, what's the future of longer run of channels and their survival? Also, why news channels are not able to get their fair share of revenue as compared to other genres wherein it is a critical genre? Now, we're not talking about only COVID days. We're talking in general because a lot of news channels keep complaining that, although we have eyeballs, we don't get that kind of price or share, which we should. So this is in also our topic. So let's close it on it and understand from you, where is it lacking?
Okay. So... this goes, I think the fundamental reason why this is happening is because of fragmentation. Now, the crazy part is that when I started my career in advertising and media, whatever, 32 years back, my cost per 10 seconds that I was paying was probably as high as most of the regular inventory. In fact, maybe even higher. The Mahabharata used to pay 1,50,000 per 10 seconds for super prime time, 10 a.m. on Sunday mornings. I'm sure there's no program, there's no way Mahabharata would have got that, for that matter, any other program is getting those kind of rates today. And if I have to take it to news, all the more so, because as you get more and more news channels coming in, the same supply, same demand for news is now getting fragmented over more and more channels. So it has a, it has a double whammy to it. So it's, in fact, it's a lose-lose in a sense to it. From a broadcaster standpoint, because it's now getting more and more commoditized, it's easy for us to act as us buyers. I'm a media buyer. So I can actually just buy it anywhere because it's not getting fragmented over so many channels. So I can just keep on driving down the price because there are so many people out there to sort of compete with. The flip side, as a advertiser, it's not that great for me because my cost per rating point or the more number of GRPs I need to buy to get the same kind of reach increases. So cost of my plan also goes up. So it's inflationary from that standpoint. So your effective rates are also going down at one level. Your cost per rating point is going up at another level. So it's a lose-lose on both. Now the solution lies in consolidation. So if you actually land up now, look at the places where things have consolidated. So you only have one place from where you can buy IPL. So prices keep on going up. CPRPs also go up, but probably the CPRP inflation is probably on par with the CPRP inflation that you might have on crowded genres. So I think the answer to this question lies within the broadcaster set, and they have to decide how much they want to proliferate.
So if I have understood it right, if we'll have lesser number of news channels, perhaps they'll have better rates.
Yes.
So I Michelle, can we take more questions, or because they said we have to close it by 3:30. I still have one or more questions.
But one more question should be good. Okay, one or
so
two
we
questions.
We can take one more question. This is again from Subharto Ghosh. He wants to ask, currently big FMCG brands or big advertisers are looking at integration and also trying to gain brand equity by associating with media. However, the SMEs and retailers, in spite of intent, are not able to advertise due to cash issues, or maybe they are jittery. What will be your suggestion to them at this moment?
Actually, I find SMEs, they probably are the most savvy, and they understand the pulse of their consumer and their market in a number of ways better than national advertisers, primarily because they operate in a very small market and they understand that well. What I've seen, the way they actually behave, is they typically try to put all their eggs into one basket. So against conventional theory, what they will do is, for example, they will go tie up with one newspaper, or they'll tie up with one channel and say, I'm giving you all my money, it's not much, but this is what it is. Now you make this worth my while. So at that point in time, the media owner actually goes out of their way, because they've actually been able to get 100% of the guy's budget, which in and of itself is also significant, and becomes that much more valuable because he has given it all to that one person. And then it becomes sort of almost incumbent on that guy, on the media owner, to be a co-partner in making this money work for them. So this we've seen, during COVID days, we've seen less. I think here, I'm talking about a general strategy, because this is the way I've seen the SMEs work. And in the process, I think they actually will land up being quite effective in market. In the very short term of COVID, frankly, I think they are the ones who have a cash crunch. So they will use very existentialistic factors to determine whether or not to advertise. But for that matter, even national advertisers, they may have the money to do fancy things like integration, but most of them are also right now being very cautious when it comes to spending.
I hope this has answered your question, Mr. Ghosh, and we are already running out of time. We have exceeded a few minutes. Vikram, before I ask you for your closing remarks and summing it up, I just want to tell all the viewers that we'll be back on May 6th with us, part 2 of this series with Mr. Ashish Vaseen, CEO APAC of DAN. And Vikram, thank you very much for this insightful session. Would you want to have some closing remarks? I mean, something, a suggestion or anything that you would like to speak on the topic before we close?
Look, I'll end on a philosophical note. The broad issue that we were discussing was authenticity of news and its importance in these days. I don't think anybody in their right mind would doubt that it's news is critical at this point in time, and it's even more critical for that news to be accurate and trustworthy. But I also believe that if we have to demand this of our newscasters, the solution of that will lie with consumers, and it won't lie with advertisers. Because unfortunately or fortunately, in a democracy, pretty much like the government, the people deserve the press they get. So at this point in time, if there are consumers who want to go after the sensational, the salacious, the stuff which is probably not at all true, but it just makes for great forwarding and shares, those are the guys, that's the kind of people that we have, and that's the kind of society that we're perpetrating. If on the other hand, we are actually feel from the bottom of the heart that this is a serious issue, and we should actually not allow even once something like this, any time you hear this, you should actually call it out and maybe name and shame the perpetrator of this kind of stuff. I think once the consumers do that, only then will there be any hope in a utopian world that authentic and credible news is also going to be valued more.
Thank you so much, Vikram. It was really inspiring and insightful. And we hope we'll have you back on some other panel sometime very soon. Thanks again.
It'll be my pleasure. You know where to find me. I'm not going anywhere from my house.
Let's hope this lockdown gets over soon.
Yes, I hope so too.
Then we'll have you live at our events.
Look forward to it. Everybody, please stay safe.
Thank you. Same to you. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much.